I'm sitting here on the Museum Square in Amsterdam with Jacquie McNish, the writer of Losing the Signal, a great book about technology disruption with BlackBerry in the main role, but lessons to be learned from every kind of business and certainly the technology sector. Jacquie, you've written a lot of books. This is the first one with international appeal. Why is that?
I think because the BlackBerry story is a story that goes beyond one company, in this case a Canadian company. It's a story of the modern race, the technology race, and how quickly a very successful business can be disrupted by competition, by new technology. And I think there's a great hunger for this story, a great hunger to learn from the experience, because BlackBerry, everyone knows BlackBerry because everyone was addicted to it the minute they got it. Mm-hmm. And I think for a long time where people were saying, how is it that something I love so much is in trouble? Because I loved this product. What happened? And it's a universal story.
Yeah. So it's also the story of first technology change and technology disruption, but also how Silicon Valley eats your lunch very quickly.
Yes. I think the people in Waterloo, where BlackBerry was based, learned very quickly how predatory Silicon Valley can be, because BlackBerry in the 2000s, shortly after it introduced the BlackBerry, owned more than 50% of the market, and it was growing and growing. And Steve Jobs at Apple and Google, they understood that this was going to be bigger than personal computers. And while BlackBerry was racing to keep up with international demand, these Silicon Valley giants said, we want that market, we're going after it.
So that's what we're going to talk about. We're first going to talk about the success of BlackBerry, and then we're going to talk about what happened and what went wrong. And thirdly, what can we learn from it, and what happens with when a company like that gets in crisis? So in the year 2000, we were first started as a small pager company. What did they do different than anybody else, and why were they able to beat Motorola?
They were able to beat Motorola and Nokia because they did not have a heavy infrastructure based on one kind of technology. Motorola was a paging company, one-way transmissions. They did not specialize in two-way transmission. And what made the BlackBerry work was that they created a radio system and a communication system that became very good at mobile two-way communication. And secondly, I mean, we take for granted that we can download videos and games and movies on our smartphones today. Back then in 1999, when they introduced their first BlackBerry, very primitive networks, Mobitex, Ericsson's network. You know, you couldn't send more than, you know, it would, if you try to download a photo.
SMS, it was an SMS network.
Exactly. And if you try to download a photo, you would have to put your smartphone down and come back to it a couple hours later.
And your battery died and that kind of stuff. They were doing it with a fantastic thumb keyboard. They discovered that you don't use 10 fingers mobile, but two.
Yes.
And that was a big invention.
Yeah, and a lot of people were in this space. You remember Apple had the Newton, and the software was flawed. It didn't work. Palm was the object that everyone loved, but it had no email. And so what BlackBerry did was that they brought us one piece of the internet, and that was email. And they did it in a way that it wouldn't overload the bandwidth, wouldn't overload the carrier's networks, because they used compression, they used packet switch technology, and all of it was encrypted and secure. And that made businesses, their core client, much more comfortable with their technology.
Yeah, and there's great things in the book about guerrilla marketing, how they gave away to the presidents of the company without the IT department knowing about it, and getting addicted, and suddenly IT discovering that 400 people were using it and of their corporate email. So that's a great story how they were successful. 9/11 was also a good moment. Huh?
September 11 was a very important moment. I mean, it was a tragic event, but what happened was because of the cell towers in the World Trade Center were the communication backbone for most people in New York. So their cell phones weren't working, their landlines were no longer working, people couldn't even phone, and so they couldn't use phones and cell phones. But what worked were the BlackBerries, and that's because they had their transmission towers in New Jersey, and they were much more secure, and they didn't overload the system. So people were finding out, were telling their families on BlackBerries that I'm okay. Some of them tragically were having their last conversations in the final moments of the tower before it came down on BlackBerries. And in Washington, if you can believe it, no one had BlackBerries except for a very few number of senators. And they were the only people in the new. They wanted to get all the senators and the congressmen to that secure bunker in Virginia. Yeah. But they didn't know how to get in touch with them to get there. And the people with the BlackBerry were the people that were in power that day. And within weeks after September 11, every congressman had a BlackBerry.
Yeah, the whole House of Representatives in 6 weeks. So yes. That is if you have a crisis, things can happen. So that was a successful thing. And then it went to the consumers, you know, the Madonnas and the Oprah Winfrey at a certain...
Yes, Oprah was a big cheerleader for the BlackBerry, and it was very exciting for this little company in Waterloo to turn on and watch Oprah wave the little blue BlackBerry that she loved, and she would give away hundreds of them, and that's when they went from being, you know, a rapidly growing company to an overnight success, because then it reached the consumer mindset.
Yeah, and the numbers, I know they had... took them forever to do a million subscribers, yeah. And then it went from 1 to 5 to 10 to 20 to about 100. 100 was the maximum amount of subscribers they had, and then now they're at 35 million. So yeah. It's still a lot of people walking around with a BlackBerry, but it's nothing compared to the big masses. So those were the successful moments. Who were the people behind that company?
There are two key people. There is Mike Lazaridis, who's the founder of Research and Motion, now known as BlackBerry. And he's a very interesting man who, you know, comes from a family of immigrants that came to Canada. When he was a little boy, he had a laboratory in his basement. And he was always very interested in computers and radio technology. And his high school teacher said to him, the person that can bring together computers and radio technology will be a big thing. And that was always his objective. He went to the University of Waterloo. His first business was in mobile modems, which were, you know, very important in the early days. Yeah. A lot of industrial applications. And then he decided to move into the hardware business. His partner is Jim Balsillie. And Jim Balsillie worked for one of his clients and was trying to squeeze more money out of him from a contract. And Mike had no sense of business. He looked at this guy and said, I want you to be my partner, but here's the deal. You got to meet my fiance first. She's a good judge of character. They got together, and Mike Lazaridis, his now wife Ophelia, walked away from the meeting and said, you know, he's a shark. And Mike Lazaridis famously said, yeah, but he's going to be my shark. Yeah,
and the interaction between these two were very successful. Jim didn't do anything with technical. Mike didn't do anything with business, and it worked for 10 years. It worked flawlessly.
It did, and it really helps if you're successful. But when the challenges come, the differences that complemented them and that worked for them became something that caused a lot of chafing. And there was a couple of key things that happened that destroyed a very successful partnership. One was the backdating of stock options.
Yeah, in which year? Because they were very, very successful. I mean, 2011 was their maximum sales year, yeah. And their market share grew until 2010, I think, or 2009. Yes. When did the partnership get disrupted?
Pretty much started at the end of 2009 when they came under scrutiny in the United States and Canada for backdating of stock options. Mike Lazaridis...
Which everybody did in those days, including Steve Jobs, in a huge scale.
Yes.
But BlackBerry got problems.
Well, the lawyers took the rap at Apple, at Research and Motion. Don't forget, this is an email company,
yeah.
So they left a trail. For the regulators. They made it easy for the regulators to go to the top. And Mike Lazaridis had nothing to do with this. He blamed Jim for damaging the reputation of a company that was very important to him. And Jim was furious that Mike didn't trust him after that.
Curious? Angry?
Furious.
Furious. Okay, furious. Yeah. Okay. So that was one thing, something stupid,
yes.
On the back, which had nothing to do with the core of the company, but rewarding. And then the regulators, when they get into your hair, they can make your life difficult, but they can burn the trust inside the company.
Right. So that was a huge public pressure. The other big issue for them was a patent battle with a company called NPR. Research and Motion played a very bad hand in the courts in Virginia. You know, it was a patent court. There are a lot of problems with patent trolls, but Research and Motion had a bad legal strategy.
Yeah.
And so it drew on for longer than it needed to for a very key reason.
Endless amount. I mean, there was damage. It was going to be out of business. They were going to be forbidden to sold. They made the judge very angry.
Yes.
And in the end, they paid it off for $500 million. But that also was damaging to the relationship.
It was very damaging. It was very stressful. They went from being this you know, the wonderful new company. It was the company that everyone loved. They could do no wrong. And then they started to do wrong. And when you start to do wrong and you've got two very different people running the company, you start to move in different directions. And what happened at Research, it was very sad because, you know, both men did a lot of good for this company and a lot of good for the Waterloo region and Canada, but they stopped really being able to communicate effectively with each other. And then the company was growing so fast, they were bringing in thousands of people every day to scale with this huge demand, to keep up with demand in Indonesia, in Africa, in Europe. And so it, the company became divided. There was no clear message from the top. Mike had one idea, which was hardware. Jim saw the future, and he was right. He could see software, but the two of them couldn't come together. So when you've got a company like that, under public pressure, you got Silicon Valley coming.
Yeah, because now we're getting to the partnership was in trouble.
Yes.
And then in 2007, the iPhone came, the Jesus phone, and they needed to change to a different technology path. What was so different on the iPhone, and what was the wrong judgment they made?
The wrong judgment was misunderstanding how the network world was changing. Research in Motion's biggest problem was that it grew up with the carriers as its client, because they could only do what the carriers let them do, because they were very controlling. Steve Jobs used to call them the four orifices, because you couldn't get anything done on your hardware unless you had their approval. And he went around.
Couldn't make an online contact address book, because they said, that's too much data, we don't want that.
And when Research in Motion introduced its first app, it snuck it in as a software update, which made the carriers crazy.
Which was Ping, huh?
I think it was. And so as
BlackBerry Messenger, yeah.
Yes. So as a result of that, they were always very much focused on conservation, traditional engineering values. Steve Jobs didn't care about that. He wanted to shake up the world, turn it upside down. So when Mike Lazaridis took apart the first iPhone, he loved to do that. He loved to take apart the competitors' phones and look inside, and he said, they've put a Mac in this phone. It's ridiculous. We give you a piece of the internet. They want to bring the whole internet to you like it's a small computer.
Yeah.
And his first reaction was, this is impossible. It was illogical to him.
Yeah, because he said battery life will be horrible.
Yes.
And this will just bring the network to its knees. This will never work.
And he was right for the first 2 years.
Yes.
They didn't work. All those dropped calls, all those lawsuits. But people blamed the carriers, not Apple. They wanted the phone. They wanted the Jesus phone.
Yeah.
And they didn't see that coming. They looked at it and said, people are more interested in beauty. They're more interested in toys and fun. This is a serious business phone, the BlackBerry. They didn't understand it. And so by the time they understood that it was the new iteration and that the consumers were flocking to this, it was too late.
It wasn't too late. They got the perfect opportunity to prove them right.
Yes.
And Verizon, the second operator, who had to miss the phone for the iPhone for 4 years, came to them and says, make me an iPhone killer.
That's right.
And they had all the chance in the world to make a beautiful iPhone killer. But what happened?
They made a mistake, because Verizon said, we want this in 9 months, because they were obsessed with keeping up with AT&T that had an exclusive contract with the iPhone. And they felt that they had to take this opportunity. They had to deliver it in 9 months. But they were delivering a touchscreen phone with a different software interface and so many other different elements that they had to put into this phone. It was impossible to think you could do that in 9 months.
And sell millions and millions of copies with the biggest marketing campaign ever.
Yes. And so do they look at Verizon and say, we're only going to do this if you give us 2 years to do it, in which case maybe Verizon goes to Motorola or someone else?
Yeah.
So it's a tough decision to make. We can look at it today and say it was stupid. And the name of the phone, the unfortunate name of the phone was the Storm.
Yeah.
And it ended up being appropriate for all the wrong reasons, because I think there was 100% return on a phone that just never worked properly.
Yeah. I was asked for the first time, I was the biggest BlackBerry enthusiastic person in Holland, and I put the Prime Minister and all the members of Parliament. I did a lot to promote the BlackBerry. And they flew me to Canada, business class, to make a video of the Storm. And I met Mike there, and we talked, and I looked at that thing. I go like, will this work? I mean, gee, it was a horrible phone. I couldn't even make a video. I came there to make a video, but in the end, they wouldn't let me make a video because it was so buggy.
Yeah.
And it was a horrible piece of crap. And I was extremely angry that they made me fly over from Holland, even though I got paid for the ticket.
Yeah.
It was a waste of my time. But that was the biggest technology mistake or product mistakes
right.
they put out, and went downhill from there.
When I think you're allowed to make one mistake when you've got a race like this going on. This is a very fast race with big competitors.
Yeah.
They made a big mistake with Storm, and then they made another mistake. They decided to copy.
No, but I mean, let's talk about the Storm, because
yes.
Verizon was so pissed off. What did they do?
Verizon dumped BlackBerry, and it went to Motorola with Android, the open system that was created by Google. And that it took off. It is what allowed Android to basically
the
exist.
The biggest carrier of America with 100 million says, not only, hey, Google, make me an iPhone killer, but also, we'll open up the network and you can do anything you want. You can do navigation, you can do video, you can do a beautiful internet browser, you can use a lot of data, and we won't object.
And it's interesting because at that point, the software race, the smartphone race became a software race. Mm. And Mike Lazaridis was sure and convinced until he retired in 2011, 2012, that it was a handset race. He didn't understand that the game was shifting, and Google and Android showed us that it was really a software race.
You're too harsh to Mike, because Mike bought in 2009 or something like that, QNX.
QNX.
What year?
2009.
Yeah.
And QNX is this great software operating company. They are people that have experience in software programs, applications for the nuclear power industry. They're now using their applications in the auto sector, and they were going
50% of the cars now have QNX built in there, the connected cars.
And so he saw them as the basis for a new operating system for the BlackBerry, which they needed because they had a lot of trouble with access to the internet and with
And it is a perfect system for it, but it took them 4 years to make. If they would have made a handset in 2011, which was perfect and beautiful internet, beautiful browser, beautiful navigation, why did it take them 4 years?
It took them 4 years because Mike really wanted to do a bit of a skunk works with them. He left them in their offices in Ottawa, which is half a day away from Waterloo, where BlackBerry was based. And he said, you guys go create a new operating system away from my old engineers, and don't be influenced by their thinking. Come up with something entirely new. But the problem was, to do that, they had to understand how the old system worked. And in the end, it was a race.
And how a phone worked, because these guys didn't have an idea and how to make a secure connection to Outlook Exchange. And that. So he made a mistake there, because he made the right decision to buy QNX, but it had the wrong decision how to integrate it in the company.
That's right. And it caused a lot of resentment. There were a lot of walls and silos, conflicts all over the place. It's very sad what happened.
Yeah. But that is a very, QNX was beautiful decision, but bad implementation. So that was the second mistake. And then, you had the playbook disaster. But I mean, that was just more a show of thing. So let's talk about a company which goes downhill. What happened in the end phase? When did the leadership leave? And what was the big subject of conflict between the two leaders, Bill and Mike?
I think for Jim and for Mike, the big issue was where to take the company. And Jim Balsillie is the guy that traveled the world, talked to all the carriers, talked to the big clients, and he was convinced that software was the future. He could see that the handset race had been taken over by Google and by Apple, and that it was going to be very difficult for BlackBerry to get there. So his decision was to build on something they were very good at, which was BBM. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to take it to a different level, SMS 2.0, which we now know as WhatsApp and all these chats. And he could see that was the one thing that they had that might be able to take them in a direction that would be profitable.
What a dramatic step. Putting it on all the handset, killing your own handset, killing your own darlings, and making an SMS choose, which they are still trying to do in the GSM. Every operator is going, what do I do with WhatsApp? It's basically killing my business. They would have jumped on it. It would have been very interesting as a chance for BlackBerry. And Mike was very late with his handset, so that was end of BlackBerry. What happened when the company got destroyed and these 20,000 people lost their jobs?
It's a very sad story for the shareholders, because the company is now worth only a small fraction of what it once was. But this is a company that had close to 20,000 employees, and thousands of those employees have left Research in Motion, BlackBerry, and they've gone into Waterloo, they've gone into Ottawa, some of them are in Vancouver, and you have these little ecosystems that are developing, technology ecosystems, these hubs that are developing in Canada, particularly around Waterloo. Research in Motion, BlackBerry, has sold all of its property. Mm-hmm. Some of those offices are now occupied by former BlackBerry executives who've launched their own startups and are starting up their own business. And that has been a great thing for the technology sector in Canada. We don't quite yet know who the next BlackBerry will be, but there are some companies that have already done IPOs that are doing some very interesting things and getting a lot of attention. So there's a very vibrant technology community that has benefited from this. And it's taken people a while. I mean, people used to wear a paper bag over their head and say, I used to work for BlackBerry. But now there's more pride because they showed us in Canada that you can create a $20 billion company out of nothing.
Yeah.
They've also showed us that you can lose a $20 billion company pretty quickly unless you respond in to the kind of things that we were talking about.
So let's talk about lessons outside BlackBerry. What can businesses learn from this technological disruption? Basically, the network going from slow to fast, and people going from texting and to emailing, navigation and design. What can companies learn from technology disruption?
I think what companies have to accept that this is not just a technology story. This is a story that could apply to any business, whether you're in banking, whether you're a lawyer and you're used to having full control over the legal profession. This is going to happen to you. It's just a question of when, not if. And you know, you look at banking and you look at Apple trying to move into its own form of banking, and you look at other people trying to create their own payment systems. And you look at the large barriers of entry that used to protect banks, the billions of dollars that they put into their utility payment infrastructure, I think they're sitting ducks, and it's only a matter of time before new digital applications will eliminate the need for those old-fashioned legacy systems that is protecting them today. And I think it's only a matter of time. And so how are they going to respond? Are they going to partner with Apple? Are they going to create their own digital network? I think it's going to be game on, and it's going to be very interesting to watch.
Yeah, so in sleeping with the enemy, you know, Samsung or Apple, which are both trying to get the front end of the payment systems, that's going to be very interesting. So which industries do you see being disrupted? FinTech is a very important one, the financial tech. Other industries you see things happening like this?
I think the professional services. I wonder about accounting. I wonder about law. I mean, today, if you want to start up in business, you can get online advice from bookkeepers. Mm-hmm. You can have a bit of advice from lawyers, young lawyers who aren't in the big firms, that don't have that heavy infrastructure, that are prepared to do piecework, if you will, in legal and accounting. You know, do you really need to go to the big firms if you're a small startup? If that's where the growth is, it's in the startup industry.
Nobody goes to the big guys, yeah. What about energy or mobility or cars and those kinds of things?
Well, cars, you're the expert on cars. I think that it's fascinating being here in Amsterdam and seeing how many electric cars there are, a lot more than we see in Canada. And you can see the future here, and you know that it's coming. We are still very carbon dependent in Canada because we supply so much of the world's oil, but it's inevitable that that's going to happen. Yeah. Again, it's just a question of when.
How do you write books? This is your fourth book. Now, you have a certain approach to books. You made a story, very much a story, a human story between Mike and between Jim, and how do you try to get these messages into a book?
I think it's very important to have a human element in any story, and all of the books that I've written have really been about the people as a way of telling a broader story. Business stories are often complex. They don't have to be. There can be a wonderful narrative. I like to create narratives. I like to be descriptive. And this was a very, very rich story to tell. We had incredible access, my colleague Sean Silkoff and I, to Mike Lazaridis and Jim Balsillie, who talked to us for the first time. They've been very quiet for years. Yeah. And they wanted people to learn lessons from their experience. And they also wanted they were ready to tell a fuller story. And so that gave us a lot of rich material to work with.
Yeah, and that's why the book is really fascinating to read from the beginning to the end, because that human element, you have the technology in there, but you also have the human element in there. So that's so now you're traveling around the world. You gave a fantastic presentation here for KPMG, one of those disruptive, soon to be disruptive accountant, according to Jacquie. But is that also what you're doing now, traveling around the world, telling this business story on how companies can learn from this?
That's part of what I do, and I enjoy it because this story is constantly changing. The conversation we had this week at KPMG, the questions lasted an hour. This is a conversation, and every speech that I give, I learn something about it, and it makes me think, and I feel like I could write several more chapters into the book because there's so many more different perspectives, and I think that people are have a real hunger for this, and they're really...
Yeah, we want to know also, hey, BlackBerry 2.0, is that going to come?
Yes, and exactly.
Is that going to come?
I think it's a matter of time. I really do. It's, you know, but I think that it will be in terms... I think this company as a hardware business is over. The move is into software. They haven't revealed their hand yet, and we'll see... We'll see down the road what they're going to do. I think it's going to be a pretty interesting company to watch for the next few years.
Jacquie, thank you very much for your presentation here in Amsterdam. Unfortunately, it's not online, but you have got the gist of this conversation. Always fun to talk to you. What's your next book?
I haven't decided yet.
Maybe a little bit of these disruptive, soon-to-be disruptive banks, but we'll see. Thank you.